in preparation for going to see the Muppets, I watched Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, The Secret of the Ooze.
Why'd you watch 2?
I don't know why I was in the mood for it, but it was appropriate because that was the one that was dedicated to Jim Henson. So there you go.
There you go.
I don't know. I'm kind of digging 2 recently. Except for the whole Vanilla Ice thing.
Yeah, well.
Well, yeah. And I was watching, this time I was watching, like literally the last line of dialogue just before Vanilla Ice comes on is like, oh man, this is going to get bad. But I'm like, oh, a truer line of dialogue has never been spoken.
You know, I don't have much faith that they're going to top the first Ninja Turtles movie ever.
You really can tell, like, how much of a genius the Jim Henson team was when you compare Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 1 and 2 to 3 and how crappy the puppeteering is in that movie.
Well, yeah. Yeah, they, like, totally just stopped trying. This movie is, I mean, and the second movie, too. But you basically forget that you're watching people in suits.
And you do have those people who are like, well, at this scene, at 10 minutes in, you can see through the actor in the suit because the mouth is open too wide.
There's the scene where Donatello's skateboarding in the sewer, and you can clearly see the hand come out, and it's not a turtle hand; it's like a orange and white jacket. But I mean, it's just like it's really quick. I mean, these things happen. Whatever. Suspend your disbelief. Stop being a jerk.
Yeah. Oh, and this is my, like, favorite fun fact, is that the voice of Splinter is the same voice of Elmo. And Baby Sinclair. And he worked with Jim Henson since, because I was just reading about him, since, like, 1983 and was part of Sesame Street since all the way back then.
Yeah.
And that's how he got recruited to do Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And the puppeteering on Splinter in the first two movies is really great.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's not a man in a suit, obviously. That was all just puppeteering.
Yeah.
And you believe, it's like, I won't go as far as saying it's as good as Yoda, but it's pretty close.
Yeah.
In terms of just a character that's a puppet that you just believe entirely.
Yeah. I remember when the third movie came out, and I loved the first two, and I was a huge Turtles fan, and it came out, and you're sitting there going, like, oh my god, like, Shredder is gone, he's gonna be the new villain, are they gonna bring Krang in? They gotta bring in Krang, are they gonna do Baxter Stockman? That would be awesome. And then you're, like, sitting there, and you're like, from the first scene, you can just feel that something is wrong, like, something is very wrong, and, like, the first time the Turtles show up, it's just not congruent with the other two movies. Then Splinter comes out, and he looks terrible.
And he doesn't, he's always stationary, he's always in one place, so it's very clear it's just somebody's got their hand up the puppet, and it's just like, he's not mobile at all.
Yeah, it's like someone draped, like, a really bad Splinter costume over, like, a couple cinder blocks. It's really bad looking. I know, like, it's like, however old I was in 93. 7 or 8, and it's like, wow, this is bad.
Yeah, it's bad.
At that age, you're like, wow, this is bad, then it's bad.
Yeah, yeah. But, oh, Casey Jones in the first movie. So good.
Awesome. That confrontation with him and Raphael in the very beginning.
Yes.
That's gold.
It's so gold. With just the insults with about the bats and cricket and...
Punker.
And I love the dynamic between Casey and Donatello.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's awesome.
Where they're just going through the alphabet coming up with insults.
Yeah. I played that game with people before. It's a good
thing. Actually, the whole sequence at the farm actually really does have some weight and some substance to it.
Well, what's great about that first movie, which, like, no other Ninja Turtles thing has really captured very well, is that it actually is taken from, like, the first handful of comics.
The first one, and to a degree the second one, did a really good job of balancing the dark tone of the source material with the kind of jokey tone of the cartoon series.
Yeah.
And they haven't been able to do that ever since. Except for that one sequence in the CGI.
Yeah.
Which is a shame. It would be, a really dark version would be great.
I don't know, though. I mean, the more I look at it, the more I think about it, the more I think, you know, the first one was pretty good. I don't know how much they need to reboot that. I mean, I don't know, like, how... If they were going to reboot it and do something gritty, they'd have to compromise. And I don't really see, like, how they would compromise and make it any better than that first one.